In the last couple episodes, we've been upgrading the interior in my 1993 Land Cruiser, and it has really made it more enjoyable to drive. It's not that it wasn't enjoyable before, but it just feels a little bit more modern and practical now when I'm driving it. And today, we're jumping right back into it with a tailgate storage panel, brand new Corbeau seats, and some other interior mods to top it off. Tailgate storage install is going pretty smooth. The part itself is perfect, but I am not, and I kind of got ahead of myself, and I cut the hole a little bit too big. So you're supposed to leave a quarter inch around the perimeter so the lid has something to sit on, and I just used my marker, you know, pushed away from the edge to make a line, and then I cut outside that line, but ended up only being like an eighth of an inch. I didn't measure it, so now I'm having to go through and add more material just to make this fit perfectly. So let me turn the camera around and show you what I'm talking about. So you can see when the hatch closes, it needs somewhere for the lid to go. So this is the part I just welded back on. Luckily, I kept the panel that I removed right there. But you can see when it goes ahead and it closes, it'll lay down on this part of the existing tailgate metal right here. Now, it's fine how everything is for the top right here. I have about a quarter inch, so that's all gonna work just fine. But the passenger side, probably only like an eighth or 3/16, and it's gonna still contact that lid. Like, it's holding it, it's supporting it, so it's gonna be fine. Honestly, I'm creating more work for myself than I need to right now, but I would just feel better if that side had a little bit more meat on it. So we're just gonna get that added, and then we'll work on cleaning out all the metal out of this tailgate, laying down some sound deadening. I do have some extra from the last video, and then we should be good. We should be wrapping up the install on this. I ended up just saving myself the time because I realized that I already was very conservative with the cut and didn't really remove as much as I thought I did. As you can see, this piece was already cut off flush with the detent for this plug, so no point to really waste any time. I just finished up cutting the rest of the opening instead for the hatch. So my neighbor just stopped by, and this always happens. We start bouncing ideas around, ends up making more work, but overall the finished product is a lot better than if I just were to leave this as it is. We were talking about how we want to trim this, the sheet metal of this tailgate in, because it's kind of just like a rough edge on this panel. And it's sharp, even though it's filed down, it's still sharp. So we were thinking, what if we use angle iron to just trim this entire cutout section so that when we open up the tailgate storage panel, we have a nice reveal and just looks really nice. And what I ultimately decided on was using something similar, just not as heavy duty. And we're just gonna go with this cheap J channel. I picked up this whole thing
for like $5.80. It's really thin sheet metal. It's galvanized J-channel. And what it's gonna do is it's just gonna perfectly slide over the rib section of the tailgate sheet metal right here. And it's gonna give us that nice reveal. For areas that are a little bit thinner, where we might need to make this clamp to the metal tighter, you can see that one here, this is the width it normally is. We could just close it with our fingertips, make it tighter so that it clamps onto the tailgate sheet metal better. Not to mention when we do tighten down the storage panel, it's going to clamp the J-channel in between the storage panel and the sheet metal of the tailgate. So what I thought was kind of funny about that was after we came up with this idea, I noticed that a similar tailgate storage panel that's three times the price comes with very similar trim. So we spent about $5 and got a very, very similar result. And then maybe in the future we'll lay down some carpet in here as well just to top everything off. This is another cool part that we have today from Bulletproof Fabricating, and this is a MOLLE panel that's gonna install on the bottom of this center console lid just to provide us with mounting space for more accessories. The problem is that these Land Cruisers came in different trim levels, and some of them have a double din with an armrest that this is made for, and some of them have that are a low trim have nothing, which is of course what I have here, which this is not made for. So it's not gonna fit because it screws in the correct application, it screws to the bottom, and then the actual bolts go through and they're covered with another piece up here so you can't see it. Obviously with this one, if the bolts go through, we'll be able to see them and it's not gonna look good. So I do have a couple of ideas where we might be able to get this to fit, and I think it'll work out. So we're just gonna go ahead and see if I can get that to work. And just so you guys know, I paid for these Bulletproof Fabricating parts with my own money. I did use my discount and I was able to work with them to be able to provide that to you guys. So if you do want to save 12% off your next order from BP Fab, go ahead and use the code below. So as I was already saying, this does not fit into my center console lid. So we are going to be faced with some challenges. The first one is that you can see it fits the recession up top. It does not fit the recession on the bottom. So normally this would be installed and it would be spaced out like this so you have room to mount everything, but on mine, what I'm gonna have to do, since it doesn't fit perfectly, is I'm just gonna split the difference. So I'm gonna move this one a little up on the lip, and now this one is down here, and now I have kind of an even area to mount to. But the second challenge is that we don't have a flat surface on the bottom side of the lid. We have this ribbed material down here, which is not what this was exactly made for, but we do have these two thicker areas. Now these are probably hollow, but my idea is to install rib nuts in here and then attempt to tighten this thing down to those rib nuts. So I might have to drill two more holes inboard a little bit, because you can see it's right on the edge of that plastic, so we're not gonna grab. But I'm willing to modify this part and also potentially mess up my center console lid, because it's just a center console lid and I'm never gonna see that. So I think it's worth it. I think the risk is worth the reward, and we're gonna go ahead and try to get this thing fitted up. I wasn't really sure if rib nuts were gonna work in plastic, especially really thin and old plastic, but
Worked surprisingly well. I've only used rib nuts and metal before, and you know, of course you get good results in metal, but plastic is soft and old plastic is brittle. But this particular ribbed section under this center console lid, it held up well. And the rib nuts worked here exactly as I intended them to, and we have a really nice solution here to mount this product on an older center console lid.
Well, now it's time for the most exciting mod of the video. I've been wanting to upgrade the seats in the Land Cruiser for a long time, and I finally picked these up to replace the stock seats. Now, these are the Corbeau Sport Seats. I was looking at the Moab seats as well, but ultimately I chose these because of the headrest, and I just like the way that they look more. So we're gonna work on getting these things installed. These are the tan color. I was looking at the spice color as well. The tan's a little bit darker, but my interior is also a little bit darker. Either way, it's not gonna match very well, so mainly chose those because I like the way that they looked more. I've been working on testing the brackets in the Land Cruiser off camera because I've heard some pretty bad things about these brackets that the seats come with. And I thought maybe, you know, it's a nice looking bracket. Maybe it's just people not installing the bracket correctly, but the brackets don't fit whatsoever. And everyone seems to be telling the truth. These things just have terrible fitment. So let me take you in there and show you what we're working with.
So here's what the driver's side bracket looks like. I'm not sure how the passenger one looks. I've only done the driver one so far, but at least on this side, it's not lining up. So you can see it lines up on the back and it will line up on the front, but it's not actually square. So if you bolt in the back, it won't line up on the front, and if you bolt in the front, it won't line up on the back. Now, the only way I can see this being able to fit is if I either expand this bolt hole, because that is literally how far off that is, either expand the bolt hole, bend this bracket and push it out further that way, or maybe cut and weld a new foot on the seat bracket. So I'm gonna try to do the easiest thing first, which would be expanding the hole, which is, I don't wanna do that, but if I can get three of them to fit with the normal bolt holes, I'm okay with having one of them kind of wallered out. So I'm gonna see what I can do to get this to fit, and we'll see if we can get the seat in here. Well, here's how we're fitting now. I got the two front bolts installed just to hold this thing in place, and I can make that one get in there, but this one, there's just no way we're gonna get the bolt in there. You can see how far off that still is, even after wallering that hole out. So this one right here lines up enough, but I still need to take off this yellow portion so that it installs without having to torque it in there with a ratchet when we should just be able to hand tighten that. This one's not even close, and we're only gonna have a little bit of material left there after I grind out that yellow part. So I did remove any sound deadening that was under this, making sure it wasn't holding it up or binding it in any way. I even cut out some of the carpet to just give it a little bit more room to slide back, and we're still this far off. So this bracket, I don't know if anyone from Corbeau watches my channel, I highly doubt it, but we need to get this bracket revised to actually fit into these Land Cruisers. I would normally return this, but I gotta get these installed, and I wanna get a video out for you guys, so I'm gonna modify these to make them fit. So I'm gonna cut out a little bit more of this section here and that section there to make that fit, so that when this bracket's installed, we tighten the bolts down, we can get them all threaded in by hand and not have to force anything in, cross thread, or mess any of the bolts or the bolt holes up. Here's the finished product. We got all four bolts installed. Nothing's bound up. Everything's finger tight. As you can see, no more issues with this, but I did have to take a Dremel and expand these holes more than I would have ever felt comfortable with. Unfortunate considering the cost of the seats and the brackets, but it fits. It's ugly, but it fits. So I'm gonna get this thing painted up, bolt the seat to it, and we'll get this driver's side seat installed and see how it looks.
Thank you.
Now we're moving on to the passenger side, and as you can see, we're dealing with the same issue as the driver's side. The bolt holes do not line up. You can see I'm putting quite a bit of pressure down on this mount, and they're nowhere near lining up. On top of that, we're contacting the heater core, so I had to cut away quite a bit of it with a Dremel in order to get the seat rails to have clearance against the rear heater. The seat bracket was also slightly contacting the transmission tunnel, so I had to clearance the corner of the bracket instead of hitting my transmission tunnel with a hammer. And I also noticed that it was kind of interfering with the seat mount itself on the floor pan. But eventually I was able to get all four bolts to tighten by hand, which is what we're going for because we don't want to bind or force anything when installing these. So I guess it's a bit unexpected because these are made for the Land Cruiser. I mean, or are they? Because it did take quite a bit of work to get them to fit. As you can see here, just how much I had to clearance out of that rear heater. You can clearly see the coolant pipe going into the heater as well as the rear area that would blow the heat into the passenger compartment of the vehicle just completely cut up in order to get this to fit. I mean, it's not that big of a deal. You don't see this and I don't care, but it's not a plug and play solution. And at $139 a bracket, I kind of expect a plug and play solution, or I would have just made my own. But eventually we were able to get them to fit. The seats look great. They're comfortable. I like them. Just wish the brackets were a little bit better. Let's talk about these seats for a minute. I searched all over the internet for anyone sharing their experience with these seats, and overall, I couldn't find the information I was looking for. So here are my thoughts at the moment as a new owner of these seats. First, Corbeau offers two shades of brown, and neither of them really match the sable interior color of early Land Cruisers, so if you have a gray interior, you're in luck. I bought the tan seats, which is the darker shade of two colors they offer, tan and spice. Either way, it's not gonna match, so just pick what you like more and roll with it. The seats look to be quality to me, the stitching is nice, there were no defects with the seats, and overall, I think they're comfortable. They have good bolstering, and the seat is taller than the stock by quite a bit, which is nice. And they also have tilt and adjustable headrests. They are firm, but not too firm, and over time, they'll probably soften up and be a little bit more forgiving. There is infinitely more adjustability with the rail and the tilt. You could definitely take a nap in your truck if you wanted to with these. I definitely appreciate that compared to the stock seats. The only thing that I can find as a negative is it raised the seat height just a little bit, and that could just be because my old factory seats were so worn out, but my head hits the ceiling if I have the seat at too upright of an angle.
Now we're gonna work on the finishing touch for the interior, and that is this steering wheel cover from Wheel Skins. Now, I don't know why Toyota decided to use a gray steering wheel with a brown interior, but the interior is about 65 different shades of brown and shades of gray and shades of black, so apparently they couldn't make up their mind, and this steering wheel cover was the exact fit for the wheel, at least as close as it could possibly be. So we're gonna get this installed. I imagine this is gonna be absolutely infuriating, so we're just gonna use the time lapse to show the install for this. The steering wheel cover is installed, and yep, just about as painful as I thought it would be. It took a lot of time. This took about, I don't know,
maybe an hour and 30 minutes of doing this and getting tangled and just figuring it out. I started off with an overstitch, as it said in the manual for it, but then I used this over-under, which I thought looked a little bit better. For the thick spoke areas, they're kind of just fake stitches, so you just do the front, you don't do the back. And yeah, that's about as good as you can make it look for those areas there where it kind of expands and goes around those spokes. So I think it looks pretty good. Looks a lot better than it did. And yeah, I'm happy with it. And that just about wraps up the interior mods for the Land Cruiser.
Well, now that I got those interior mods done, I need to get into this shop. So if you've been following the channel for a while, you know that a couple months ago I finished this shop and I'm still not in here yet.
So this is my 36 by 48 workshop that I just had built last year. I think it's been done since October or maybe November. And as you can see, it's still empty. I'm not in the shop, and that's because I need to get power out here, but I have to pull power 220 feet underground, 3 feet deep all the way to this shop in order to comply with Idaho Power and install the whole box right here on the wall. And there's no lights, there's no electrical, and I need to coat the floor. So what I'm gonna do for now is I'm gonna run extension cord power in this shop. I'm gonna get some high bay lights hung up there, and I'm gonna use Ghost Shield to coat that floor, because the next thing I need to do on the Land Cruiser is build the axles. I've been driving around on 38s with stock gears, and that Land Cruiser wants to blow up. It does not like what I'm putting it through. It's bogging down everywhere it goes. It takes forever to get up to speed. We're putting way too much strain on the motor, and it's getting like 6 miles a gallon. So we need to put in some 488s or 529s to match the tire size. We need to lock it. It's not even locked, which means it's not even capable. And I don't want to do any of that in the garage. I want to do it in my shop. So it's about time to get out here. We're gonna start working on getting power out here, like I said, even though it's gonna be extension cord power for now. And we're gonna start building some really cool stuff in this shop. So stay tuned. Thank you guys so much for watching. As always, give this video a thumbs up if you enjoy it. Subscribe to the channel if you're not already, and I'll catch you on the next one. Later.